as usual, this is the session to make my students be very clear and confident with the knowledge, concepts, understanding and application of the same. So any student has any question, you can straight away ask me, or you can send a question through your WhatsApp to the panel members, but they will be rigorously engaged with me. Yeah, we can start.
Good morning, sir. How does money multiplier affect money supply?
It's all about liquidity in the economy, in any economy. When you look at the liquidity or supply of money, when RBI or any central bank of any country, RBI in India, when they want more money supply, they try to cut down the reserve ratios kind of thing. They try to pump more money into the economy. So money multiplier is one indicator to know to what extent money is available for capital investments or to some extent consumption also, because even lending is done for consumption also, FMCG, retail loans are given. So money multiplier, money supply, money multiplier, they are related. Money supply is seen through or controlled through money multiplier. Okay. For example, CRR ratio, cash reserve ratio, say 5%. 5% means if, say 10%. 10% means 1 crore of deposits are there, means 10% should be maintained with RBI as CRR. So 10% of 1 crore is 10 lakhs. So if RBI has 10 lakhs, means economy has 1 crore, 10 times. If RBI has 1 crore, means economy has 100 crores. That is money multiplier. If government wants to bring down the money supply, they will try to increase the reserve ratio. That's how it works.
Nowadays, and previously what I mentioned, they have taken from measure the money supply.
Since the concept of central banking has come, these concepts are there. Okay, in India in 1920s, central bank concept has emerged, and in Europe, I think much earlier, they are there. So these M1, M2, M3 or reserve money, or base money, then narrow money, then broad money. So as Madhavi was asking, to know the level of money supply, these M1, M2, M3 are closely monitored. Historically, yeah, since the inception of RBI, it is there in India. Yeah, she was asking, Madhavi was asking about money multiplier, you are asking about fiscal multiplier. Fiscal, the word fiscal, fiscal deficit, you know, fiscal multiplier, these things are related to the budget, the kind of spendings government is doing on the public. So for every, if you remember C plus I plus G, if you remember the GDP when we arrive at total consumption, total investment and total government expenditure. Okay, this expenditure could be investment expenditure or consumption expenditure, both could happen. So the impact of government expenditure on national income is traced. Okay, so delta y, change in GDP or change in income divided by change in government expenditure, that gives you the fiscal multiplier. If the income is not increasing with the government spending, there is no economic value added to the economy. That's how it is.
Sir, what is the role of contribution in
price making
decisions, both in short run and long run?
Oh, you want both? Okay. Simply, contribution, the concept of contribution comes into the picture. This is part of CVP analysis. You are worried about that, right? So, CVP analysis is done more with pricing decisions. When a firm wants to fix a new product, startups are on nowadays, most startups are coming. So when they are worried about pricing, they should know about all the cost elements. And they should also know what is the target profit. Okay. And not only that, within the cost elements, what is a mix of fixed cost and variable cost? That is also important. Why it is important is, if I put my own money in fixed assets, I don't consider the impact of fixed assets or fixed cost. but I will be worried about variable cost. Fine. But in the case of manufacturing companies, where people, they tend to take more of borrowings, for them fixed cost is everything. So whenever they try to sell, they price the product, fixed cost is a major component. So if it is your own money or contributed money or gifted money to buy the assets, you will not worry about the fixed cost. There will worry about contribution. Contribution is sales minus profit plus variable cost. Okay, it is simply sales minus variable cost. I'm sorry. So along with profits, you add contribution also as a kind of profit, because you're not worried about the impact or cost of capital incurred on fixed assets. That is the idea.
Sir, how does demand for money influences supply?
So demand for money, supply of money.
How influences?
Okay. So maybe a question to you, which comes first? Is that demand for money or supply for money? Which comes first?
Demand.
Yeah, there's the answer. That's how they're related. According to the demand for money, I think you take a transaction motive, speculative motive, or any other motive, portfolio motive, profit motive, or asset motive. Okay. These kind of motives make the people to hold the money. Okay. Maybe it will be in the form of narrow money or in the form of broad money, M3. Okay. Where they doesn't want to put their money in equity, real estate kind of thing, or corporate investment, they put their money in fixed term deposits. So based on the demand for money, accordingly the money supply is getting adjusted by the central bank. If people are trying to keep their money with themselves, kind of risk-free thing, and there will be a gap, okay, from demand for money from the corporate to supply of money from the retailers, importantly. So this gap has to be filled by the RBI or central bank through its monetary policy. So that's where there should be a match between demand for money and supply of money. I hope I answered your question. Okay.
Sir, what will happen if RBI increases repo rate?
RBI increases repo rate, first of all, it is discouraging to business. No business community would like to see repo rates or interest rates going up, because anyone tries to borrow more, but at a lower cost. When interest rates are increasing, you know, I don't think people will be encouraged to do business. Business itself is felt as risky, and cost of borrowing is high because of increased repo rates. So people will be discouraged to do business. So when this kind of phenomenon is happening in the economy, it will hit the GDP also. I think sentiment is hit negatively. So usually, yeah, repo rate is used as a tool to cut down the inflation. When income levels are very high, economy is booming, you know, income is high, economy is full employment level, and people are buying more, okay, everyone is buying everything, that creates demand beyond the expected level, pushing the prices upward. At that time, RBI increases the repo rates to discourage the unwanted consumption. So it has both that.
Sir, how Accelerator works on economic development?
Of course, see, Accelerator is all about the private money. Okay. Multiplier is all about the relationship between increase in income due to increase in investment. That's what we talk money multiplier as. But Accelerator is the relationship between increase in income due to increase in investment. Who is investing? Not government. There is no G here. Only private investment. When private investment is see, if you look at economies like Middle East economies, UAE, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, Oman, kind of countries, I think government is spending more money. For them, it doesn't work. I'm talking about Accelerator. But if you look at third world countries or developing economies like India, government intervention is more. They cannot see the demand coming down. They want the demand to be up and up or steady. They doesn't want that to fall down. That's the problem. Okay. So for that, they intervene and try to boost the investment. But till what extent they will do it? If like it happens in USA or UK or other capitalistic form of economies, where only private people will be investing more and more. Okay, they do a lot of investments. Government is just a policy maker. They don't do anything. Okay, you got my point? So, more than multiplier, as you rightly pointed out, accelerator effect is important for any economy. That's what Modi government is doing in India with the concept or with the punchline of make in India. Is asking private people to put more investment. Let it be in, from India or outside India. It should be a private investment. That is a good indicator for any economy.
Sir, making
India
is a plan of India. The same plan is
executing
other countries. What will affect the exports or our GDP?
It's already happening. Of course, for the first time, we are doing in a promoting platform. But every country is doing in its own way. Look at China. There are many FDAs in China right now. There are more FDAs, not just indigenous capital, indigenous investors. There are many non-Chinese companies putting their money. But they didn't propagate like Modi was doing. Modi has to do it because ours is not so robust. You know, ours is a mixed economy. Chinese economy is a controlled economy. They can do whatever they want. It is completely, whatever the ruler, the president or the prime minister feels, it is easy for them to do. But here it's not easy. Every person has a right to voice out. That's the reason he is making use of all platforms. Of course, competition will be there. That's how the BRICS have formed. Let us not have competition within ourselves. The BRICS economies had some understanding. Let us promote out of our own region. That's the idea.
Sir, is CDP analysis as same as break-even analysis?
Break-even is part of CVP analysis. CVP analysis is cost, volume, and
profit.
So, what happens to profit when you change, when there is an increase in volume? Keeping cost and selling price the same. Selling price and cost are the same. But when you change the quantity or volume, what happens to your profits? That is the idea. In that, you have PV ratio, contribution, as she was asking about contribution, how to make money with the help of contribution, and how to calculate the per unit the cost, per unit profit, kind of thing, per unit contribution. Then what is the percentage of contribution I have, which we call as PV ratio. Then break-even is the most popular tool used by many companies, importantly startups, when they want to sell. They have a plan. They have, every company has a budget sales, annual sales. This year, we need to sell 10 crores. So, 10 crore sales means divided by selling price will be give the quantity. But they will be eager to know, in this quantity, where is my break-even? Where will I come out of the break-even? They will be very excited to know that. Out of that, where is my target profit? And where is my budget sales? That's how CVP analysis.
Analysis is different from blue chip companies.
That is okay. There is no principle definition or law or concept on this. This is a nomenclature widely used by economists, analysts, policymakers, business people, and so on. But as you have asked, blue chip companies are those companies which are well reputed for making profits. Okay. So, if you take an Indian example, Sensex 30 companies, Nifty's 50 companies, you can consider them as blue chip companies. Because they have a long history of making profits. And they are so strong. If at all they come for public issue, all the investors have confidence on them. They are ready to invest. Whereas multinational company is a company which operates out of their home country. And in a big way. In a big way. And you have a lot of non-multinational companies in India. Similarly, you may have Indian MNCs going out of India. Like if you check Infosys or TCS, they are almost wherever a country is in requirement of software solutions, these companies are there. So that's how they are Indian MNCs. Like that, even Hero is out of India. I did not tell you about Apple or Nike. kind of brands where they are across the world. They are multinational. That's quite simple. The repo rate is from others. Reverse repo means RBI is selling. Obviously, selling price will be greater than
buying
price. That's how the difference is there. Okay?
So why does saving depends on real rate, real interest rate, not on nominal interest rate?
Savings?
Yes.
Okay, please. Understand the difference between real and bank term deposit. Hardly I get 7%. Okay? I should also consider, as you are asking me, why should I consider inflation rate? How much is the inflation rate? Any idea?
4.7,
sir. 4.7. So 6% minus 4.7%. So it is 1.3%. So what does it mean is the real interest rate the bank is giving you or you are getting from the bank is 1.3. Why? Because whatever the income you are getting, it is already seen through escalated prices. It is for you to know beyond the inflation rate where you can put your money. That's the reason people go for real estate, equity markets, and other very risky ventures because they want more money. Got it?
Sir, Prabhucharan, my question.
Prabhucharan, yeah? Charan?
Sir, how that twin deficit affects the economy?
Sorry?
Twin deficits.
What is it, twin deficit?
It's a difference between the government budget balance to current account balance.
Okay, please, please. So, Prabhucharan has a. Question on what is the impact of twin deficit on
economy, sir.
Economy. So twin deficits, as Charan was any company, as you are asked about fiscal multiplier, you asked me that. Like fiscal multiplier, we also have fiscal deficit. So this fiscal deficit was first introduced in the tenure of VP Singh in India. He introduced that. It is not a nominal budgetary deficit. You should also include fiscal deficit. It means that to what extent government has the borrowings to spend to public. You should add that. That is one deficit. The other deficit is current account deficit. Current account deficit is a deficit between your imports and exports. Okay. So both have different dimensions. These two are different problems. Fiscal deficit is government has borrowed and spent it. It has to repay. It has to give the interest rate. And it has to give the principal repayment also. Got it? That is one problem. But in the case of current deficit, I think for most of the countries, it's not a problem at all. Because when a country is looking for rapid economic development, they heavily rely on imports. They don't care for it. And for a country like China and India right now, we don't care about imports. Why? Because we are second in foreign exchange reserves. We can fund. We can support all the imports. If at all, like it happened when P.V. Narasimha Rao government came to power, this kind of situation was not there at that time. At that time, current deficit is a serious threat. Forget about fiscal deficit. Okay? So, independently, it has to be seen from country to country, and this is how you can look at Indian economy. Clear? Charan?
Sir, I have a
question. Yeah.
Is CVP analysis accurate?
There's nothing like accurate or not. See, the kind of responses I'm giving you, are they accurate? The questions are always there. The point here is, CVP analysis is a popular tool used by many managers, CEOs or top level managers to arrive at pricing decisions. Okay, but to what kind of accuracy? It is all about their belief system. It is not necessary that you follow CVP. You have your own strategies. You can have. But CVP says some common sense. This is your cost, okay? And this is your fixed cost. This is your variable cost. This is the level of quantity for sale you have. And desired sales budget you have. And it is very easy to play with these numbers for you to arrive at a decision, okay? Say for example, you have some set of price, okay, and cost is, you can't change the cost. Cost is already sunk. It is historic. You can't change that value. So with the given selling price, if this is the cost, okay, where is the break even? Say for example, some 10,000 units, you got the break even. I can't wait till 10,000 units. If you feel that way, then you have to change your selling price. Increase the selling price. You can get the break-even quickly, maybe with 8,000 units. That gives you some platform to analyze your own things, to elevate price. That's it.
Nowadays, banks are getting merged. What is the reason behind it?
I think I personally had, I'm so happy banks are getting merged. Since many decades I was contemplating, when I was young like you, you know, banks are special, nationalized in 1964, again nationalized in 1980s, I used to see that. But when I started, you talked about MNCs, right? Why? When we talk about MNCs, we talk about HSBCs, Citibank, you know, kind of investment banks or commercial banks. I hear a lot of big foreign banks. But I never hear, importantly, when I was out of India, I'm not finding Indian banks. I'm getting all the, they're serving me for my Indian transactions, but they're not Indian. You got my point? So the problem here is, India is the biggest economy. Indian stock markets are in top 10. Maybe now they're into top 5 also. India, based on GDP, Indian economy is in top 5. But Indian banks are nowhere in top 10. The reason here is banks are very small and competing within themselves. Instead of that, if they merge together, become bigger and compete, that is a real competition. That is a very good move. Personally, you can analyze that. You can question that also further. Maybe next time when we meet again. So that is a good, so I am personally very happy. I am very happy to see that. And I want two or three big brands from India, like HDFC, SBI, ICICI, you know, and they go out of the country and reach many people. Not serving Indians, serving foreigners. I wish they also become MNCs. Charan?
Yeah, so what is the reason why exchange rates are most analyzed and manipulated in economic developments?
Yeah. Okay. Now, why you are feeling that they are manipulated? Manipulation has a different meaning. You mean to say they are fixed? Oh, you feel that they are manipulated. Please sit down. But they are not manipulated, first of all. When you look at the exchange rates, there are two forms. Okay. One is fixed exchange rate. The other one is flexible exchange rate. Okay, flexible exchange rate is market driven, based on demand and supply. Based on demand for foreign currency, say US dollar bought in Indian rupee, US dollar sold in Indian rupee. Through this is the exchange rate between Indian rupee and dollar. That's the idea. Okay, in that case, when it is exchange rate, when the exchange rate is moving every day, it is not manipulated. It is driven by demand and supply. When more FDIs are coming to India suddenly, means more dollars, supply of dollar is increasing, then exchange rate will come down. You can ask me why it is going up and up, it's not coming down. Maybe our government wants exchange rate to be higher because our exports will be cheaper. That is the reason. Okay, even maybe as you say, as you would use the word manipulation, sometimes central bank in India, RBI, comes into the market, they try to stabilize the market. They don't want foreign exchange rate to fall down. Okay, then what they do, when the exchange rate is falling down, maybe many people are selling dollars, exchange rate falls, then RBI will enter into the market and it will aggressively buy the exchange, foreign currency, so that exchange rate will go up. That will happen. Okay,
sir, what basis foreign exchange
demand and supply? As simple as that. If there is no demand for US dollar, you don't see that 70 plus rupees. No way. It will come down to 50 rupees, it will come down to 20, 10, or 1 rupee also. If suddenly US economy goes into recession, there's a big problem in USA created by Trump or some economic factor, and no one is willing to hold a US dollar. Everyone is switching to gold. Everyone is buying gold or maybe cryptocurrency or euro dollar. You don't find demand for dollar. It will slide just like that. It means there is no one demanding. As simple as that.
Sir, many multinational companies are
less than 1?
It can be. Money multiplier less than 1 means, for example, I told you example of 10 times. 1 crore, 10% is the CRR ratio, means 10 times. Okay. Money multiplier is 1 means where huge ratio reserves are maintained. It will not happen, but if at all central bank wants to have that, it will definitely do it. It means that 1 crore is a deposit of, it's not possible yet. I think it's not possible. Because RBI, ICICI has a deposit of 1 crore, it has to put equal amount of 1 crore. Where it will get the money? How it will do the business? It's not possible, but maybe sometimes where central bank wants to cut down the whole monetary system, they may do that. They may, but practically it is not possible.
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah.
What are the problems encountered in measuring GDP in developing economies?
Measuring GDP, that's a big problem here actually. Whatever the GDP, first of all you have to understand, GDP is measured based on consumption, consumption side or earnings side. Okay, so spending recorded value or money is taken. Okay, central statistical organization in India, it takes care of a part of it, and as you independent person's revenue is reflected with company's revenue. So broader triggers or points are taken to cover the income of that. If you look at the GDP, it is a sum of all the company's sold product value, which is seen through as profit or whatever. Okay, so what does it mean? Products were sold to someone, they are buying, for that they can be resold. That is a secondary issue. But primarily the companies which are doing this, yeah, that is a recorded value. Problems are definitely there. Instead of saying that, we are following one set of rules or platform to arrive at GDP. So in that way, problems are less. But questions could be, why are we following this? Why can't we do another model of GDP? That debate is on.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Sir,
Kishore
has a question.
Kishore? Yeah.
Growth rate increase or decrease upwards?
Okay, maybe your question is relationship between money supply and GDP. No, impact of money supply and GDP growth rate.
Yes.
That's what
growth
I said.
Plus upwards or downwards?
Whatever, it is a relationship. You are trying to know the relationship between money supply and GDP growth rate. Yes, sir.
Pressure on interest rates.
That's what? Money supply and GDP growth rate. That's what I was answering her. If you remember, I was answering Madhavi when she asked me why repo rate is increased or decreased, whatever. That's where money supply comes. When you're increasing the repo rate, money supply is cut down. You're discouraging the economy or business communities. When money supply has to be increased means interest rates or repo rates have to be cut down. That boosts economy. GDP growth rate will be up. But it is a challenge for RBA when inflation is there and people want more money. I was talking about Raghuram Raji in my earlier sessions. The whole country was looking for repo rate cut. But Raghuram Rajan was never ever in a situation to cut down the repo rate. Everyone hated Raghuram Rajan during his tenure. Once he has gone away, whoever came in his place, they all cut down the repo rates. Inflation was stable, repo rates were down, GDP's growth rate is on. It never came down below 5%. That was a good sign. That's a challenge for policymakers. Pavan?
Why reserve money is important in the economy?
Reserve money. Okay. You are talking about M1 or reserves with
reserves
RBA.
In the economy, RBAs.
Okay. See, banking system, we all are mad of money, please understand. Yeah?
Yes.
If there is no money, I don't feel we all will sit here. Yeah? So, and one, who is holding our money? Banks. banks are playing with our money, you can say that. Banks are playing with our money. And if RBI doesn't keep the reserves with itself, I don't think they can control banking system, first thing. Forget about money supply. It's a very good tool to control, or it is a kind of surveillance to monitor the whole banking system, all the commercial banks. Fortnight based reporting system is taken from all the banks by the RBA. And reserves are very important for an RBA. Like I was answering your friends, it gives an indication to what extent multiplier is there in India. If you have the reserves and the ratio, you know this time, this many times money is supplied in the economy. Similarly, it is also a good controlling measure, banking controlling measure by the central bank in India. It is mandate. Without reserve, we cannot imagine. We cannot imagine.
Sir, how FDI different from FPA? And why are they putting restrictions on FPA?
RBI is putting restrictions on FPA?
Yes, sir.
What are the restrictions?
Some percentage of they have to invest. Other than that, they should not.
Yeah, you also have the same? What is yours?
In the case of IMX Media, they kept only some limit of amount should be invested.
Oh, you're following that. Very good. Okay. Okay. First of all, each and every company, first I'll answer her question. Each and every company will be stipulated by SEBI. To what extent of FPA can be done in that company? That is the first thing. That depends, there is a set of parameters to follow. All companies are not equally eligible for FPAs, like you talked about INX. Okay? Like that, every quarter, things will be changing, every quarter. Okay? If they want to change, they can change. If they are not changing, they will be like that. But every quarter, SEBI will give the... look at the companies and their limits. That's how it happens. Answering your question, Ramesh, first of all, FDI and FPA, FDI is directly pumping money into a company. Anyone outside India, foreigner, company, independent person, foreign government, whatever. FPI is buying the, doing the investment, but in the securities issued by the companies. Okay, the difference here is FDI is to direct business participation, they are contributing to business. But in the case of FPA, you buy today, tomorrow you can sell and go away. That is your choice. And restrictions should always be there. Should always be there in FPIs. Because with the problem we had is Nirmala Sitharaman wanted to tax capital gains tax on FPIs. That's where the noise came out from FPIs. Then she also suggested, then you convert yourself from society to a company, then the tax rate will be a little better kind of thing. That's how she prompted. Yeah. Sorry? Tanuja? Yeah.
Sir, what problems will be erased if the capital formation in the economy stops?
It's a terrible situation. It's a terrible situation. It's a terrible situation. Capital formation, we want money, right? What happens if my salary stops? It is the same way. Economy has to, money is the fuel, capital is the fuel to have economic growth. Any company, any country, any person, they want to grow. Even forget about growth, if you want to sustain, survive at the same level, capital should be there. Without that, it's very difficult for an economy to create jobs, increase the income level, increase infrastructural developments, provide infrastructural options for new investors or whatever. That is mandatory.
Sir,
Teresa
has a question. Teresa? Sir, what are the measures taken by the manufacturing sector from the recovery in the pain of introduction of GST?
First of all, GST was a good move, I personally, but number of slabs should be cut down to 2 or 3, there are many. Then initially when it was introduced, that has happened, all the, you talked about manufacturing company, right? Manufacturing companies, you know, they were in doldrums, they were lost, you know, how to price further, whether to cut down the cost, how, foreign competition is there, multinational companies are here, they don't care about the profits, they just dump the products, you know. At this kind of scenario, GST has come. Okay, so that's a challenge at that time. So respective industrial associations, they approached finance ministers at the time. Who's the finance minister?
Arun Jaitley.
They approached Arun Jaitley and they said, this is what we don't want. We want some breathing space. We are suffocated. These are the problems. Everyone, they said that. But all are not considered. Some of them, like you take FMCG. FMCG's GST from 28%, it came down to 18%. So all went with the request, with the associations, you know. But the Ministry of Finance, through their committees, they assessed each industry very closely. And they understood their problems from the requests. They analyzed them. If that is really problem is there, yeah, they considered that and they cut down the GSTs. To maximum extent, things are okay right now. But definitely, but the other point is, Johnson & Johnson was penalized by Indian government. One body is there. They cut down the GST from 28 to 18%, but those fellows, they didn't pass on the benefit to the consumer. On the name of GST, they increased the price by 28%. But when the government gave FMCG a breathing space, relief, but they didn't bring down the price from 28 to 18. So they cornered, they put a penalty of several crores on Johnson & Johnson. Yeah.
If saving dropped sharply in the economy, what would be like to happen in this minute?
I think that's what I was answering Tanuja. Capital formation is all about savings. If there are no savings, I think investment will not happen. Okay. If you directly invest, that's a different thing. Okay. Savings are the channel to reach investment, which we can also call it as capital formation or capital accumulation. A person who is earning with some salary or income, he or she can't dare to spend the whole of the salary with zero savings. Maybe that could be your question. Zero savings, a person cannot survive. Okay. So for that, there is a different phenomenon. It is American culture also. What they do is, they do the future spending right now. They spend 20 years of spending right now. They try to do like that. They can't buy a home today. Okay. But they buy it and they spend it every month or every year. That is a spending in their sense. But it is a kind of saving which has already gone to investment. Similarly, a car or whatever, there are many options. So indirectly, that is a kind of saving for them also. But without saving, it's difficult. But a person or a company or, you know, in India, farmers, it has become quite common to commit suicides. The reason? Savings. They don't care about savings. They wish to see money in their hands. And they just burn it in the same day if possible. I'm not blaming everyone. People who are in trouble, I'm talking about only farmers. The farmers who are in trouble, the problem with them is they don't have financial discipline. Okay? Neither they postpone the spendings, nor they increase the income. Some indigenous bankers, loan sharks, in the village, they come at the doorstep. Rauya, eight chapra, double kawala. They say like that. Whatever they want, they give it instantly. And the interest rates are huge. You'll be surprised. There'll be 10% per month, 5% per month, maybe 100% per month also. People take body organs. Do you believe that? It happens. If the person commits suicide, they take the family members into the custody. Wife, kid. They want money, that's it. They don't want anything else. They take their organs also. So savings is quite important for every person, every company, every government.
Thank you. Revati has a question.
Revati? Yeah.
Besides GDP, what other indicators that influence the wealth, sir?
Wealth of a country?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. No, please sir. GDP is first and foremost, it's your income. Your income is increasing, mean your wealth is getting accumulated. Out of that, you also have, when you talk about, though foreign exchange reserves is not asset, foreign exchange reserve also shows your richness in terms of foreign currency and foreign liquidity. That is also quite important. And capital accumulation, as Tanuja and Madhavi were asking, what is the rate of capital accumulation, capital formation? That is also an indicator along with GDP.
Kamalakshi?
Veeraji, yeah.
Sir, if the GDP is at risky stage, and what are the measures and the precautions the government takes?
Risk, what do you mean the risky rate here?
Like if the GDP rate comes down, and what are the precautions and measures they take to control it?
Okay. Maybe you are indirectly asking what is the problem, how to solve problem in Indian scenario. India has the problem right now. First of all, let us understand the BRICS. The BRICS economy is in the limelight because of their GDP rate only. I think 5 years back, all of them are close to 10%. Close to 10%, some of them crossed even 10%. Okay? China, India, they had even 12% GDP growth rate. Why people are looking at countries with high GDP rate? As Revati was asking, she already confirmed, yeah, GDP is one great indicator of wealth. Okay? When GDP is growing at a higher rate, means he's the wealthiest person. Okay? But the problem here is, if the GDP rate comes down, you already have a status of rich person, a wealthy person. Now it is coming down. When that comes down, like MNCs, FDI, you are asking about, MNCs, you guys are asking about, and these people will lose the charm. And they try to look for another wealthiest economy. So when these people go away and the party is over, that is where the fear factor comes. Once in Mexico it happened, its interest rates are high, GDP rates are high, interest rates are low, GDP rate was going doing very well. And suddenly they slipped into recession because all the foreign investors, they started diverting their money to some other economies. The reason is GDP rate was falling down. That happened in late 80s and 90s, I'm talking about, not now. So that's how GDP rate is there. But how to make the GDP rate to move upwards, I think you can follow RBI Governor Nirmala Sitharaman and what they are saying. They have the best efforts to do that. And you can also check at American economy, maybe UK, France, Germans, they're dying. They are the most developed economies, developed countries, but still they don't have GDP. You can check their policy reviews. They give you a lot of clues on what to do. They are the efforts. See, even we plan, it may not happen. It is all about effort. So practically we can check that out. Prasad? Yeah.
What explains the fact that China's GDP is more than 3 times that of India's?
Okay, you have to understand there is a difference between GDP and GDP growth rate. Did you get that?
Yes.
My salary is say 10,000. Her salary is 1 lakh. Are you getting my example? My salary is 10,000. Her salary is 1 lakh. And my salary growth rate is 10%, her salary growth rate is 5%. Okay, so GDP growth rate has become a phenomenon nowadays. We stop looking at GDP, that's what he is asking it. He is worried about GDP, not GDP growth rate. How come GDP of China is much higher than India? So here you should keep one thing in mind. The size of the country, geographically, size of the country in terms of population does not make GDP. A small country like Japan is not a small country, Singapore, Switzerland, these countries are much bigger than Pakistan or Sri Lanka or Bangladesh, countries which are our neighbors. They are very wealthy. It's all about making money. So till 90s we never had focus on GDP or size of GDP. But now we got it. The way you are trying to, as I was trying to answer Kamalakshi, the way the government puts the efforts to increase the GDP, if it works, yeah, it gets increased by many folds. If no one is bothered about it, policymakers or government, I think it doesn't work. Okay? So Chinese, not now. We all are worried about GDP now. They are doing very well in 60s and 70s also. They never had, someone was asking about twin deficit. Charan was asking about that. China never had a current account deficit. They are always surplus. Exports more than, but they are always surplus. Will you believe it? So that kind of a vision they had. So it's very difficult for us to match them. But still we are doing that. We are close to them. In China never thought that. India will come close to us. That's the reason they are not able to digest like Pakistan. They are also crying against India because they never imagined, thanks to Modi's leadership.
Sir, Somnath has questions.
You have it?
Pravallika has
it. Pravallika? Pravallika.
Sir, if we get money through a lottery prizes, it becomes a other income. Why it's not an investment income? Or a personal income?
You're talking about a person?
I person.
So there is nothing big in this. My regular income is salary income. If I put my money in bank, I have to file my IT returns every year. I have to show there. The government will clearly ask me, tax people will clearly ask me, salary from, so I'm sorry, income from salary. Then I have one more clause, other income. If it is other income means, as you said, income from investments, bank deposits, shares, real estate, agricultural income, it doesn't have any tax. Okay, like you said, I got a lottery, I won KBC, that is also other income. So these things are treated separately to tax it. Tax purpose, they have a separate head, nothing else. Okay, for companies, if you look at their regular income is selling their own product. For Infosys, software software programming and consultancy is the product. That is a regular income. And they put other income. What is that other income for a company? They have invested somewhere. They received dividends. They received interest. They sold some assets. Capital gain. Those will come under other income. Okay? That is also income. So when you make total income, all put together, it is total income for that year. Government, hey dear, this is your income, please pay tax, not just salary. Yeah.
Suresh?
Yes, Suresh.
As per Keynes accelerator concept,
sorry?
As per Keynes accelerator concept, in what way investment is key component for aggregate demand?
Oh, you want to link investment with demand?
Demand, yes.
Okay. Please sit. So, can you answer my question? What do you feel? Investment should come first or demand should come first?
Investment.
Okay. So, anyone who is looking at investment, for example, government is investing. Fiscal deficit, we talked about. Government is spending. It will identify key areas like infrastructure. Apart from that, needed things like water supply, irrigation, telecommunication, surface transportation, air transportation, airway, whatever. They will identify key things. Why? Because demand is there in those areas. Okay. They can't invest in mining, deforestation, global warming. All these problems are there. No one will look at investment in those areas because no one is demanding that. You got my point? So coming to multiplier effect, where what is the impact on income with a given one unit in increase in investment? Your question is, in this relation, how, what is the link between investment and demand? So investment will follow demand. It is a cycle. According to demand, investment happened. Investment happened, income increased. Because of increase in income, new demand will come. It is a cycle. But as you asked me about investment, investment happens based on the demanded areas. Okay?
Pavan?
Control of money supply is done by government.
Okay.
What if there is any chance of corporates having its control on money supply? It affects the economy in which way?
According to you, give me a way where corporates can control money supply. I just wanted to know.
Sir, control of money supply, while they are investing into any business or when they are starting any business, the flow will continue.
Hmm.
For the business, the flow, money flow will be continued. What if the government gives the permission to control that money supply into the economy? What it happens?
Yeah. See, money supply is a very broader thing. Corporates or government itself or an independent human being like you and me, we cannot control. The idea here is M1, M2, M3, as simple as that. Reserve money, narrow money and broad money. What is happening to these three is important. That's it. Okay. Corporate, for example, a company raised 500 crores very recently. I think Supreme Industries came for a public issue. They came for an IPO. 500 crores. They raised money. That is capital accumulation. Raising capital from public and investing somewhere. Okay. So how do you see money supply here? You can see money supply here. 500 crores worth of money is there in broad money, M3, in terms of deposits. But now M3 has gone to investment. So M3 has come down. Broad money by 500 crores, it has come down. It is good for the economy. It has gone for investments. But your question could be, these people have raised 500 crores for what? Are they really investing or not? Or they are diverting the funds? There are many corporate cases happening. SEBI takes care of it. Got it?
Sir, in India, industrial and service sector more developed. Why not agriculture sector?
I thought someone will ask that question. Thanks, Ramesh, you asked me that question. We are copycats. We want what America is doing, we want to do that. What Japan is doing, we want to do that. They are the big brothers. Let it be fashion, the way we live, you know, the way we are talking in English, whatever. We try to emulate the leader, as simple as that. Americans, they are not the torchbearers for agriculture. It's not an agricultural economy. Okay? Australia, yeah, to some extent. But they are, because of, you know, ozone problem, you know, highest paid person in Australia, any idea? He's a truck driver. He gets the maximum salary. Because the sun rays hitting the skin, you know, it creates a lot of problems. The reason is because of the global environmental problems, they're not supposed to manufacture or do something like that. Things should be natural. That is the idea. If America turns a kind of agricultural economy, damn sure India will also turn and India will become global leaders. When Atal Bihari Vajpayee was the Prime Minister, he got that idea. He wanted to do something, corporatization of agriculture. You know, small piece of land held by small farmers. Maybe 10 cents, half an acre, 1 acre kind of thing. So his idea is to accumulate land in one area. 50 acres, 1000 acres, 100 acres or whatever. They will accumulate it and give it to one company. And these people will become both employees as well as shareholders. That's a beautiful concept. Okay. Unfortunately, in 2009, he lost the elections. In 2004, I'm sorry. He lost the elections. Again, Congress came to power. If he would have been in that, I think India would have seen a different economy. But still, I'm with you. I don't know. With a pain, you asked me that. If that is the case, I'm with you. I want to see that kind of Indian economy. We got huge potential. Instead of migrating from villages to towns and towns to cities and stressing the cities, stay back in your own place and become wealthy wherever you are. That is a very good system, a very good model of developing an economy. Let's hope it happens in Indian future. Yeah.
Sir, our India has implemented a Make in India program so that other country people can manufacture here, so that which results in decreasing importing. What if other countries like China and Japan implement the same act like make in China and make in Japan, our country will people move there and manufacture there.
I think that was already answered. You asked that. It's that I think China and Japan, they don't require that because they are already there in global platform. Everyone knows China and India. Prior to Modi, nobody is aware of India. Make in India is a concept and it traveled across the world to be at par with BRICS or China or US or whatever. Even premium pro prime ministers or pro presidents like American president or German chancellor, whoever it is, they started looking at Indian prime ministers and they started a different body language when Modi goes somewhere. Even in future, whoever else is the prime minister, the same kind of value will be given because India is in limelight. India has a different picture. For them, competition is already there. China is doing everything. China is dumping into India. Forget about attracting others. It is directly creating competition. It's trying to kill Indian sellers. And we are strong enough to work against them. If you take steel industry, steel, China is number one. We are number two. But still we have our own plans to dump our steel into China. They are there. Yeah.
I would like to thank Dr. Raju Indukoori sir for sharing the knowledge with us, and it is very helpful for us to learn about business economics in the real world. And I would like to thank the people who came forward and to ask the question for this session. And finally, I end with saying thank you to each and everyone who participated and supported making the session go well. And we would like to have this session again and again. Thank you all and have a good day.
I hope you are okay with my answers.
Yes,
see you soon. All the best for your exams.
Thank you. Yes.